Hey, this is Michael Bohm with Youth Apologetics Training. Today, we're going to keep going on this slavery series, Slavery in the Bible. What is God's position concerning slavery in the Bible? And so, yesterday we talked about foreigner slaves. Now, today, we're going to talk about that scary topic of female slaves. And we're going to be answering questions like, did God say it was okay to rape your slaves, or, you know, have a whole bunch of slave wives? And how does that work? Could you just marry a slave and use an abuser and then divorce her and send her on her way? Could you just sell her to somebody else? How did that all work? There's a couple of scriptures that seem to confuse people. And the new atheists love to take those scriptures and run with them. So today, we're going to look at that and find out what is God's position about female slaves. And we're going to find out, once again, as you already suspect, God's going to show himself to be loving, kind, and he's going to be the God that steps in and takes a less than ideal situation like war and does something wonderful with it. So with that, let's jump right in. What about female slaves? There's all these things that get thrown around about female slavery and how fathers would sell their daughters to be somebody, a slave or a wife. I mean, how could this be done? I mean, check this out. Exodus chapter 21, verse 7 through 11. And just listen to this. If a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, she shall not go out as the men servants do. And right here, this next verse, I've seen multiple websites on the internet talking about how women were sex slaves. We're going to get into that. But this verse right here is the one they always quote. All right. They say, if she please not her master, who hath betrothed her to himself, then shall he let her be redeemed to sell her unto a strange nation. He shall have no power, seeing he hath dealt deceitfully with her. And if he have betrothed her unto a son, he shall deal with her after the manner of daughters. If he take him another wife, what? Another wife. We'll talk about it. For food, her raiment, and her duty of marriage shall he not diminish. And if he do not these three unto her, then shall she go out free without money. So there's a lot of issues here. We got this guy who betroths a servant. He gets married to her, but she doesn't please him. I mean, what is that? And what does he do then? He allows her to be bought by somebody else. Okay, but apparently he can't sell her to a strange nation. Okay. And then we have people marrying servants off to their son. Okay, that just sounds horrible. And then we talk about polygamy, if he take him another wife. All right, we got all kinds of issues here. Okay, does this bother you? Well, it, you know, from our typical mindset, it probably would. Let's look at all this stuff. So why? Why in the world would a man sell his daughter to become a slave for marriage? All right. Let's look at it in context here of what we already know, okay? What do we know? Well, we know from the Bible, guys. Let's be realistic here. We know from the Bible that parents are supposed to love on their children. They're supposed to raise them upright. They're not supposed to be cruel to their children, okay? We've looked at scriptures like that. And so we got to look at these verses in context of the whole Bible. I mean, of course, we've got scriptures in the New Testament about how you're not supposed to provoke your child to wrath, provoking them to anger, these kind of things. And we know, okay, that's New Testament. But going back to the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, we know that these parents are supposed to love on their children. So what's going on here? Why would somebody do this? Well, let's look at some reasons why a parent would sell their child into a slave situation where they were to be married off. Well, you may have a poor family who is unable to support their daughter, and that they're actually in a situation where this is the only option. But keep in mind, again, if this daughter is to be married off to the slave or the master's son, the master's supposed to treat her like his own daughter. If she's to be married off to the master, well, get this. She just married into a wealthy family, and he's supposed to love her. She's now his wife. She's not a servant. She's not a slave. This is not a sex slave, guys. This is his wife. And again, Exodus 20, verse 8, if this man mistreats his wife, she's set free. That's it. So if he beats on her, if he forces her to have sex, stuff like that, she is to be set free. So in this situation, she has laws protecting her too. She's to be loved as a wife, not a slave, okay? And since we're already talking about this mistreatment, let's look at that verse 8 again, okay? Because that bothered me. Man, that bothered me. I was stuck on that for a while. If she please not her master, who hath betrothed her to himself, then shall he let her be redeemed to sell her unto a strange nation. He shall have no power. Okay, in other words, he cannot sell her off to a strange nation, seeing he hath dealt deceitfully with her. What are we looking at here? Is God saying you could just marry a woman, and then if she doesn't please you, and by the way, if you look that up, please not her master, it's not talking about sexually, okay? I'm not saying I like it. Okay, it's actually talking about pleasing to the eyes. And I don't like that. But what are we looking at here? At the end of the verse, it says, seeing he hath dealt deceitfully with her. All right, so this guy is a schmuck. Okay, he married a woman and decides he doesn't want her. All right, what is this verse saying? He decides he doesn't want her. He's a schmuck. He can't just go and sell her to another nation. He has to allow her to be redeemed. And what does that mean? One of her family members, one of her kin, whether uncle, brother, whatever, can buy them or buy her into their family and take her in and take care of her. So what does this look like? All right, so obviously we're not talking about a slave of war here, right? Because this man sold one of his daughters. All right, so he sells one of his daughters in a slavery type situation. So most likely we're talking about debt here, right? He sells her off as a slave. The master betroths her and then decides he's a schmuck and he wants to ditch her, okay, which is ridiculous. And that guy will be judged for his own sin. And God's not saying, hey, this is cool. God says he has dealt with her deceitfully. And if you know anything about the God of the Bible, that is not looked on well. And this guy will get his. But what this is saying is he can't just go and sell her off to some other nation. He is to give her back. She is to be sold back to her family. Okay? And this is a bad situation. This is a situation that has gone bad, but this here verse is saying, hey, you just jacked this girl. Okay, you dealt with her deceitfully. Don't make it worse by selling her off to another nation, make sure she gets back to her family. All right? I don't like this whole situation. And it's clear that the Bible doesn't either, because it says that he acted deceitfully. This is a verse protecting her, not him. It's not saying, hey, this is okay. Hook up with me, you know, these women and deceive them. It's all right. No big deal. Just make sure you give them back. No. All right. So this is a descriptive verse about something that this guy did, these schmucks do, that's wrong, and how they are to deal with this woman after they've done this stupid thing. All right. So basically, if the woman is divorced by her husband and she is in a slave situation, this is across the board. This is with all different reasons why you would be enslaved. If the husband basically marries you and then he decides, okay, I'm a schmuck, and he divorces you, this is protecting the woman and setting her free, giving her back to her family, or just flat out setting her free. Let's look now at what it is to be a slave of war, oh man, and then be married off to either your slave master or your slave master's son or something like that. All right, what exactly is going on there? And I think already some of you were thinking, well, that doesn't sound too bad, because I've already touched on this a little bit. But how does that work? Okay, so a war has happened, and the survivors that potentially could start a rebellion or whatever are taken captive, right? They've been made slaves. And first of all, in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 13, it says that in this case, if you're planning on marrying this woman, you are to let her mourn for her family and just for the whole darn situation for a month. And some of you are thinking, wow, that's not very long. Well, okay. They get a month to mourn their whole situation. And keep in mind, again, they're slaves of war. God is protecting his people from these people rebelling against the Hebrews. He wants to make sure they don't rebel. And not only that, but again, God is giving them the opportunity to be made one with the Hebrews, to actually, you know, over the years, be treated with love, with kindness, with respect, to be educated in their ways, to be brought up amongst the Hebrew people and treated respectfully. God's giving that opportunity to them. Now, most likely this woman has lost her husband in this war. In fact, guaranteed. I mean, that's what happens, right? Now, this woman is going to be married off to this man. She will not have to work the fields. She's to be treated as a wife. All right, so now she's moved up the ladder of mistreatment, okay? She's not making license plates like our slaves or our prisoners of war. She's not in these, you know, prison cells. She's being married off to a man, and she's to be treated like a wife. Again, is this a good situation? No. No, war is a bad situation, guys. That's bad. But again, we're not talking about God's perfect will here. We're talking about God's permissible will. This is what happens after the war. Okay, things just got bad. All right, the worst of the worst happened. There was a war, and the Hebrews won, and they took captives to stop a rebellion from taking place. All these women have lost their sons and their husbands in the war. I mean, that's what happens. Okay, this is bad, and now God is giving them an opportunity to start over. And not only that, but they're coming from these cultures that would sacrifice their children on altars to Molech or to some other god. Molech came in many packages. He had many names, and many different cultures back then had some kind of a Moloch-like deity that they would sacrifice their children to. And obviously not all children got sacrificed to them, but you know what I'm saying? They had these wicked, ungodly practices that were eventually going to lead them to spend eternity in hell because of their rebellion against God. And now God is taking them into a Hebrew, these women, into a Hebrew family to be cared for, to be loved on, and to be nurtured and trained up in the true faith, to be introduced to the God of the Bible. Okay, let's stop right there, and we're going to pick right back up with this whole female slave thing tomorrow, because there's just so much to cover here. There's a lot of angles, and well, we're going to talk about polygamy. Today we're going to talk a little bit more about the treatment of female slaves. And so with that, let's go ahead and jump right in. So what does this woman get out of it? This woman who is a slave of war, she gets a chance to marry. She gets a chance to live, a chance to be taken care of, because let's face it, women had a very difficult time taking care of themselves back then than they do now. It was a lot harder for a woman to make ends meet back then because of just the society back then. You couldn't find a desk job. It was hard for a woman to find a job in the field, work in fields, manual labor type jobs. I mean, let's face it. Women don't have the muscles that guys do, so they had a harder time getting a job. They couldn't work machines because machines weren't around back then. So I know this is a little offensive, but it is what it is. It was hard for a woman to find a job back then. And so here we have a woman being taken care of. She's allowed to marry. She's given children, which is what every woman wants, is to be able to love and to nurture and to raise children. Not only that, they have children who will ensure that that woman in the future will have somebody to help and take care of them, right? What if the master dies? What if the master dies and whoever the next of kin is not a good guy and he's a schmuck, and she ends up out on the street? She's got her kids. She's got a chance. She's got, I hate to say it this way, but she's got a life insurance plan. She's got a team, a group of people, a family that can band together and try to make it in a cruel, unfortunate, bad situation. You know what I mean? So there is that aspect. Her children may have the opportunity to go free someday. That master might latch on her children and think, this is my son and daughter. I love this child. I'm going to raise them up. I'm going to give them some of my land, some of my flock, and they are going to be to me just a Hebrew child. And so there was that opportunity, which was wonderful. And we see instance after instance in history, and I believe even in the Bible, where these foreigner slave women would eventually, after a few generations, you wouldn't even know the difference. Their descendants were basically Hebrews. Wouldn't even know the difference. And that is awesome too. These Gentile people would be grafted in to the Hebrew people. These women were loved and treated well, respected and treated like wives. And if they were not, okay, the typical laws of the Old Testament applied to them. You were supposed to love people and treat them well. Okay? You don't kill them. You don't beat them. You don't mistreat them. You don't rape them. All right? They were to be treated well. Let's move on. I want to look at polygamy in the Bible, because that verse out of Exodus touched on polygamy. And I don't want to make a whole podcast out of this. I'm going to do a series on this eventually, probably touch on this subject multiple times, because Mormonism really likes the idea of polygamy. I mean, they can't do it nowadays, but they're very friendly to the idea because, well, let's face it, Joseph Smith and Brigham Young taught it. But polygamy in the Bible, what is up with that. All right. Polygamy is not God's plan. God's plan is for one man and one woman. Again, I'm not going to go real deep into this, okay? Eventually, I'll do a series, and we'll look at a whole bunch of scriptures on this, okay? But all of you guys know, just shooting from the hip here, you guys know that God's intention for marriage is one man and one wife. Now, we also know, science has figured out nowadays, that genetically speaking, more women are born than men. Not much, but the percentage of women versus men being born is a little bit off. Women are born more than men. Not by very much, but they are. So when you multiply that small percentage change by millions of people, you're going to have a lot more women than men. All right, let's take it to the next level. Let's face it, guys, we don't live as long as the women. Why is that? I don't know. Maybe it's because we're always busting our back and doing stupid stuff, trying to work really hard. I don't know. But men seldom outlive women. So there's that problem. Now we have this off ratio of guys dying before the ladies. And when guys are out in the field or building buildings, they're more likely to die at work as well, while the women are home taking care of the kids or whatever. All right? So again, we're not talking about this is God's perfect will here. We're talking about, oh gosh, things didn't go as planned. Now we got a lot of women who do not have husbands. They don't have a means to take care of them type situation. What about war? We touched on that earlier. These women, oftentimes in times of war, well, you know, in war, who gets slaughtered? Almost always, it's the men. Okay. All right. So in these times of war, you have all this excess of women. You have, and sometimes it had to do with just the fact that Hebrew men would go out to defend their own country, to defend their own countrymen, and a lot of them wouldn't come home. So there was this great gulf between the percentage or the numbers of men versus women. And so there were times where in order for a woman to have a chance, she would have to marry into a polygamous situation where one man had many wives. Again, this is not God's perfect will. But when you have all these women who have really not much of a way to support themselves, the best situation they can have, I mean, really, at that point, we're not talking about the best situation, but a close second to the best situation is to find a rich guy who can take them in and not use them as a sex slave, friends. And by the way, I just want to mention, in the Old Testament, rape was strictly forbidden. Deuteronomy chapter 22, verses 25 through 27. Rape was forbidden. Deuteronomy chapter 3, 17 and 18. Prostitution was forbidden. Okay? And sex out of marriage. Again, that is fornication. It is forbidden. So these women were not taken in. They were not married to be, you know, wives that you could just kind of, you know, like your concubines, you just show up and have sex with them and leave them. This was a situation where these women wanted this situation so that they could raise a family. And again, women love children. Well, so do guys, but you get my point, right? These women wanted to have children. They wanted to have these children they could raise. And yes, that was also a life insurance plan for them when they got older. If things got sour for whatever reason and things didn't go very well for them, they still had their family. Okay? And this is a fact of history that unmarried women in this situation, you know, would end up either in slavery or prostitution. I'm not, again, this is not God prescribing women to, hey, either you marry into a polygamous family or you become a sex slave or a prostitute. No, but God knew that that's what happens. That's what would happen to a lot of these women. And so rather than choose that, they choose to marry into a polygamous family. They find a good guy who's got a lot of money. He's wealthy. He's able to give them children and take care of them and give them a chance at life, even though they've had a bad hand dealt. All right? So again, not the perfect situation, but an opportunity. All right. You don't have to like it. In fact, I hate it. The whole situation stinks, okay? I'll be honest with you. I mean, first of all, war. War is tragic. I mean, the things that happen in war. And then you have the people that live through the war, these women and children, and they've lost their fathers and their brothers. And they're by themselves. And then they get taken captive. Again, from their perspective, this stinks, okay? I mean, they're taken away from their homeland and they're brought into Israel or Judah or wherever they end up, okay? And then here they are given to a family. And after a proper amount of time has passed and they've mourned, they get married and they're in this situation where, you know, in this situation where they're just one of a few wives or many wives, and they're deprived of that love and that cherishing that women deserve. Well, okay, I don't want to get into that deserve mentality, but women crave, okay? They don't get that now in a polygamous situation oftentimes. I mean, that, I guess, would be kind of weird no matter what. But the whole situation stinks, okay? It's weird. It's not right. But what are you going to do? I mean, come on, guys. Let's face it. The war's over. They're not going to make it. I mean, what? You know, they're going to try and survive in that situation. They are captives of war, first of all. You don't want them mounting a rebellion. But then they are given a chance to live, and they're given a chance to survive. And those women, yes, they're put in a polygamous situation. Some, okay, let's keep this in context. Some of them will be put in a polygamous situation. But they're given a place to live. They're fed. They're taken care of. They're supposed to be loved, okay? That might not happen every time, but they're supposed to be loved. They're supposed to be treated as a wife, and they're given children. These children they're able to raise as a mother does, loving those children, and they're still given that family. All right? Again, it's weird. It's screwed up, but that's what happens. Okay, war stinks. And it is what it is. And they're still given that opportunity to have a semi-normal life after a very destructive thing happens. Okay? And God shows his mercy through a really bad situation. So I think that's a good place to stop. Again, these are not sex slaves, okay? They're not to be raped. They're not to be taken advantage of. You cannot have sex outside of marriage. Again, that is God's law, okay? If people break that law, that's a whole other thing, okay? And that's against the Bible. And at that point, you can attack the person, but you can't attack the Bible. You can't rape them. You can't take advantage of them. Sex outside of marriage, that is fornication, and it is forbidden. So, all right, I think I'm talking in circles now, and so that's a good place to stop.